I'm sorry, I'm not welcome.
So am I alive? I don't know, I think I seem to be alive, but there's a difference between being alive and live. So I just wanted to check out, because today we are not in our studio. I am far away from Bangalore in a lovely place called Sakleshpur. Beautiful weather, nice drizzle, lots of open spaces, and here I am in our first session, which is in the afternoon. So from now on, every Saturday we will be live at 2 o'clock and not at 11 o'clock. Okay, so let me start off with today's topic. That is, if you reach out unconditionally to people, we sometimes do not get reciprocation. So we've heard so much about this thing called unconditional love and all that. So what does it actually happen? Firstly, I told you, when we talk about love or anything connected with that, you know, what happens is that there is a difference between the noun, that is the emotion called love, and the verb, which is the action of love, a loving relationship, for example. So what we need to do is to understand what these loving relationships are, and how do we deal with that, and what is this thing called unconditional love, reciprocation of love, all that. I'll quickly take you through, then we'll, as usual, we'll have an open discussion, and we'll have this thing of having a brainstorming and all those things. We will start off soon. So let me start off with first understanding that when we give out what we call as unconditional love, why do we need reciprocation? If I am giving unconditional love, then I am giving unconditional love, no? Let's say you give charity. You see that somebody who is very poor or not able to take care of himself or herself, you give away something in charity. Do you expect anything in return? No, you don't. So you are very comfortable saying that, no, I am giving and that's it. I don't want anything back in return. But in all relationships, we do want something in return, right? There is in fact no relationship without expectations. Relationships are primarily based on expectation. If there is no expectation, there is no relationship. But giving of love or receiving love, giving some affection and receiving affection, doing good gestures and getting back good gestures, does not work automatically as in the laws of physics. Human beings are so different and so predictable that we need to know that we are, capable of getting the right type of affection, the right type of love from people, and particularly from people whom we care for, not from the people whom we don't care for. That also is there, no? See, if you are getting unwanted attention, affection, love from somebody whom I don't like, obviously, I'm not happy. I want to push that person away. I get irritated. Why is this person, putting so much of time and attention on me? It's disturbing me. But what we do is that we give love to somebody. We give unconditional, so-called unconditional love. I'll talk about that later. That one, two things are very clear. The first one is, if I say that I'm reaching out unconditionally, then why do I want reciprocation? If I complain to somebody saying, here was this neighbor, this relative, this family member, whoever it is, and I have always been reaching out to that person, I've always been doing some good deed or the other, I've always been trying to be nice to that person in so many ways, but see, he is not in return doing anything for me. After so much of my doing also, this person just doesn't want to do anything for me. So the basic question that arises is that why do I get upset when I'm getting this lack of reciprocation? Let's start with first understanding what is this thing called unconditional love. However much you may disagree with me or even get angry with me, let me tell you, there is no such thing as unconditional love. Sometimes we have different types of requirements. When we do something for somebody, sometimes we want it in material form, sometimes we want it in emotional form, sometimes we want it in whatever other form. But the point is that we do want reciprocation, so let's at least be frank enough to admit that there is no such thing as unconditionally reaching out or unconditional love or anything like that. It just does not happen. If that is the case, then comes the question that how do I get it? You know, when these when the students enroll for our diploma in counseling skills, I give them a questionnaire. And in those questionnaires, one question that I ask is, tell me your qualities which make you lovable. Firstly, of course, there are these very interesting people who say, I mean, why should I have qualities to be lovable? Everybody should love everybody else unconditionally and this and that. I won't even go into that because that's a different, you know, topic altogether, and I'll talk about it some other day maybe. But right now what I'm asking, I'm commenting about is of people who say, I love everyone or I love so many people, so I want those people to love me, isn't it? When I'm giving them love, they should give me love. Now that is a fallacy which we don't understand. We need to understand and focus on the fact that it is not a simple matter of give and take. If a shopkeeper says, I am selling these goods, people should give me money because I have these goods on display, no? But what do people do? They come and look at your goods. They say, no, I don't like it. You say, I'm giving it very cheap. They say, even if you're giving it to me cheap, I don't want it. I'm not interested in it. When that happens, how can I be upset? So what do I do? If I'm a shopkeeper, I make sure that the goods are saleable. And what do I mean by saleable? Goods which are of interest to other people, which other people like, which other people want. Then even if my price is little higher, they will say, no, this is really what I wanted, this has got value for money, this is something which I really I'm looking forward to and I need, so therefore I don't mind spending a little extra money, but I will buy it. Now immediately the question comes up, that's okay for business transactions, that's okay for commercial activity, that's okay for buying and selling. Why are you equating that to relationships and why are you equating that to emotions? Because unfortunately emotions and relationships are almost the same as business relationships. There has to be a give and take. There is always this factor of what I call WIIIFM. What is in it for me? What am I getting out of this relationship or this gesture that I'm doing or this reaching out that I'm doing to somebody? Am I getting something in return in whatever way I want it? So, you know, there's that old English proverb which says, do unto others as you would like them to do for you. I disagree. What I want and what the other person wants is totally different. So how can I do unto others what I want to be done? What I need to do is to do for the person what he wants or what he needs. And there again comes a very important thing. There's a lot of difference between needs and wants. Take a very typical domestic example. A man works very hard in his office, he's extremely tired, he wants to come back and unwind. But he got very late. Instead of reaching home at 6 o'clock, 6:30, it became, let's say, 8 o'clock or 8:30. 8:30, that person reaches home and his want, his desire is, I want a hot cup of tea to unwind. Now his wife, who loves him extensively, wife, mother, whoever is the homemaker, she says, it's your dinner time. If you have tea now, your appetite will get spoiled. So I'll make nice, fresh, hot food for you. Come and sit. Within minutes, I'll give you nice, hot food. That's what you need. Agreed. That is what you need. A person who has come back home after a hard day's work does need nutrition, nourishment, food, whatever it is. But what is his want at that time? He says, I'll eat little later. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if a little bit of my appetite is also gone. What I want now is tea. So, what is tea? Tea is my want. Food is my need. So, what is my want and what is my need? If you really care for someone, you not only have to fulfill his needs, you have to fulfill his wants. Sometimes even at the cost of sacrificing his needs, like I told you, this person is already hungry. He's tired. Nobody can deny the fact that his need is a good hot meal. But there are times when we have to sacrifice that. Think of another example. You have a 90-year-old grandfather. He's diabetic. But he craves sugar or sweet. And he says, at least put half a spoon of sugar in my tea. You love him, you want him to be healthy, you want to do whatever you can. So you say, no, I've got this substitute for sugar. He tries it out and he says, no, it doesn't give me the same satisfaction. I like only sugar. I want sugar. Now the person, the caregiver, starts telling him, see, you know what doctor said, no, sugar is not good for you. You should not be. Hey, Baba, one teaspoon of sugar with my tea. No, it's very bad for you. You should not be having sugar. Now, if his, you know, sugar is completely controlled, he doesn't have any intake of sugar, he may live for another 5 years or 10 years or whatever his lifespan remains. But what is the quality of life? At that age, when he has lived for decades and decades, he's come to the sunset years. And he's not obviously a very productive member of society. He doesn't go out, he doesn't work, he can't do much except to lead a very decent and respectable life at home. Now, when that is the case, is it very important that he lives for another 5 years or 10 years? Or is it important that every day that he lives a happy and satisfying life? So if he starts having that sugar in his tea, what is likely to happen? His life will be cut short. He was going to die at 96, he will die at 93. So what exactly is happening? What is, again, the same thing of need and want. His need is to avoid sugar. His want is to drink his tea with the taste that he wants. He's got very few wants left in life, no? And one of them is to enjoy a hot cup of tea with sugar. Now, these are some of the things which are controversial, I agree. Somebody may say this is right, somebody may say that is right. Somebody may say, no, I think it's not just quantity of life ahead of him. You know, he'll get complications. He's a diabetic. His health will suffer. Yes, his health will suffer. He's an educated person. He's lived his whole life. He's understood exactly what doctors say. He knows exactly what diabetes is. He's willing to take that risk. He knows that I may suffer because of it. My eyesight may get bad. Whatever other factors may happen. But he still says, I want that, you know, spoon of sugar in my tea. Now that is what I am saying, that when we do this, when we fulfill the wants of people, your chances of getting reciprocation become very high. But if I take that stand that I will keep giving to people whatever I feel is right for them, now that I think Go ahead, do it. Maybe what you're doing is right also. But you will definitely not get reciprocation, right? People will not appreciate it. I know so many people like that, homemakers, other people, who sacrifice their whole life. I am doing this for the sake of my child. I want my child to have a good education, good upbringing, this. So I will see to it that he goes for this coaching, he spends so many hours, you know, studying, because it's good for him. But then who decides what is good for him? Who decides that getting into medicine or getting into IIT or getting into something is what is the ideal life? He may want to become a wildlife enthusiast, he may like to become a musician, he may like to become an artist, and his quality of life may be far better than that of a software engineer or whatever else is supposed to be good for him, right? Taking these things into consideration, we have to constantly be aware of what we are giving and what we get. Now that brings me to another interesting factor. In our childhood, we used to hear this proverb from elders, particularly grannies, saying that a mother does not give milk to the child till he cries. In different forms, that was the proverb. Even a mother gives milk to the child only if the child cries. What does it mean? It means that when the child cries, the child is indicating to the mother that I am hungry, and then the mother gives the milk. Supposing the child is lying down happily, giggling, laughing, whatever it is, the mother may not even realize that the child is hungry, isn't it? So life starts from there. As we grow up, children learn how to ask for what they want. A child will come running and say, I want a hug from you. A child will come running and say, I want you to cook something, this, I like to eat this, please cook that for me. As the child grows up, the child may even tell you, no, I just want to be alone, okay? Leave me alone, I don't want to be her people. No, I'm there with you, I'll do this, I'll do that. Yeah, I know. Normally I would welcome it. But today, no. I don't want your presence, I want to be left alone. So you see how as children, we learn how to ask for what we want. But as we grow up into adults, we are taught you can't make demands, you can't keep asking for this or that. You have to be quiet. You have to, not the done thing. It is not right for you to make these type of demands. But that's what I was telling you, that if I do not make those demands, how does the other person know? There are times when I hear somebody saying, so and so is my spouse, my life partner. So, he or she should know what I want. We've lived together for years and years. You mean to say that person doesn't know what I want? Yes, maybe he or she does not know. For various reasons, other person is forgotten, other person is insensitive, or whatever may be the reason from his side. But from your side, did you take the trouble of saying, this is what I want? Now when I say this, some people have a negative response. They say, if we have to ask for something and get it, it could be a hug, it could be money, it could be time spent with me or whatever it is. If I have to ask for it, the fun is gone. What if you demand it and say, this is what I want, and then the person gives it to you? What's so great about it? I want it to come spontaneously. Okay. If it comes spontaneously, excellent. You'll really enjoy it. But if it doesn't come, I was giving the example of life partners. You're going to live the rest of your life, maybe 20 years, maybe 60 years, you're going to be living together. So, what is the harm in teaching the person to know what you like? So, if you say, if this happens, I enjoy it. There was a very nice anecdote I had come across the other day, that, there's this couple that gets married, and the young girl in all her enthusiasm, you know, tells the husband that I was told that, you know, you don't like coffee. I actually love coffee. Normally I would enjoy having coffee, but what I'll do is I will give up coffee. I'll make tea for both of us so that we can have tea together. Is that initial honeymoon phase of their relationship? And this one said, no, you can make tea, you can make, I will make only tea. He doesn't say anything. And the story goes that she keeps making tea. Though she likes coffee, she doesn't make coffee because she says, my husband likes tea. And I'm going to only, make tea, and I'll give tea to my husband. The story ends with the husband being on the deathbed and then telling the wife, you know, we've been married for 70 odd years, and I wanted to tell you that it is not that I don't like coffee. I do like coffee. But when you insisted that you will not make coffee and you will make tea, I kept quiet. And so, for the last 70 years, I have been giving up on coffee, you have been giving up on coffee. You get the point. I mean, this may be an anecdote or a joke, but the fact remains that you have to express to the person and express it on a continuous basis. If you really like that person, if you have a long-term relationship with that person, you need to keep continuously expressing to the person what is it that you like, what is it that you dislike, what is it that you want from the other person. If you keep doing that. Now, on the other hand, there are people who keep doing good to others without, you know, informing them what I want in return, or without expressing their own needs and wants or whatever it is. Generally what happens, and that is the reason why I selected this particular topic. Say A is always giving to B, in whatever form, emotional, mental, physical, financial, whatever it may be. If A is always giving to B, at some point or the other, B starts presuming that this is how our relationship is. This is what A wants to give to me. B doesn't even realize that by giving me something, A has expectations of getting something back. They take you for granted. This happens not only in close relationships. Let me caution those of you who are counselors. You have a friends group. If you are a counselor, you know what happens slowly. Your friends start coming to you and pouring out their issues. Starts with one person, two persons. Slowly, slowly what happens is, most of your friends, whenever they have an emotional issue, whenever they have this need to talk it out with someone, they come and talk it out to you. Now, one fine day, you have an emotional need. And you try to reach out to these people. You will be amazed to find that they are not coming up to your expectations at all. They will either say things like, what if I tell the other person, you know, today I'm feeling very upset, I'm feeling very pulled down. You know what the B tells A? Come on. You help other people when they are pulling down. How can you be pulled down? How can you be depressed? You are there for everybody. You solve people's problems. You can obviously solve your own problem. I'm sure you can do it. It must be just a passing phase. It's okay. Go ahead with it. You are capable of it. I wanted you to give me that support which I have been giving you since a long time, right? Whenever you had an issue, you reached out to me and I was always there for you. Once when I'm asking you, why is it that you're refusing to give me? So either the person believes that you are capable of looking after yourself because you are solving other people's problems, or rather you're not really solving, but you're giving emotional support to the other people. The second thing that happens is that B thinks, okay, even if A, who's been helping everybody, who's been supporting, who's been a counselor to everybody, is actually going through an emotional turmoil. You know what B thinks? I am not competent enough to help this person. this person is at a much higher level emotionally and mentally compared to me. So when that person is at that high level, who am I to give support? Who am I to be there for that person? No, I think this person needs to go to somebody who is much more competent. But that person is reaching out to you. The person is actually talking to you and saying, I am upset, I am feeling lonely, I am confused, whatever may be the issue. In what way are you reciprocating to that person? We are not, doing that. And that is why this person may have a sort of, a burnout, saying that when I do good to so many friends, so many acquaintances, neighbors, anybody has any issue, I reach out unconditionally. But once when I'm asking for something, I don't get that reciprocation. Because the other people have got used to you being the giver and they being the taker. There's another very important aspect to it which not everybody agrees, but I am convinced, so I am going to tell you. We feel jealous of those who help us. Remember that. If I am perpetually at the receiving end and I have this friend, relative, colleague, whoever it is, who is always helping me, I'm very thankful initially. I owe a lot of gratitude to that person. I understand that this person is really helping me. But as time goes past, I start realizing that this person seems to be in control of his or her life all the time, and I seem to be the person who always needs emotional support. So I start feeling jealous of the other person. And then all the more reason that I do not reciprocate. I do not give what the other person has. So, before I end the first half of this session, let me give you some quick points. As I told you, I am out of the studio and out of the city. So today I don't have, Anis with me to put on those lovely slides which she makes with a lot of nice graphics. So I'll just, recount to you and you can either note it down or whatever it is. So what are the steps to deal with these type of issues when you feel that, I am giving to people but I'm not getting back from people. So what is it that I can do about it? Starting with the first thing, please be selective whom you are giving to. Whatever you're giving, emotionally, this, that, whatever it is. When you want to give, you're a kind-hearted person. You're a compassionate person. You care for people. You want to be nice to people. Please be selective. If you feel the other person can hurt you, the other person will ignore you, the other person will really not come up to your expectations, then don't. There are so many others who need your support and your help. So select carefully. You obviously are not a savior that you can go about taking care of the emotional needs of the whole world. You can do it only in a limited manner, right? But don't do it for anybody and everybody who walks up to you. What I want you to do is to ensure that you are selective. I think this person, whether the person gives back to me or not, at least that person will be neutral, the person won't feel jealous of me. And maybe once in a while the person may reciprocate to me. Then test that person out, whoever you want to help or whoever you want to support, Test that person out by doing small good deeds. See what is the reciprocation from that person. See how that other person is, responding to you. If that response is not very nice, remove him from your list. If the person's response is good, then you can start off. Okay. Now you are building up a relationship with somebody. You are willing to give unconditionally in that relationship. You are willing to go out of the way or whatever it is. Tell them what you are doing. A simple thing like, supposing I had some other work which I am sacrificing to reach out to this friend who wants my time and attention right now. Tell the person, yes, you are important to me. I am going to spend time with you. It's a pleasure to spend time with you because I genuinely care for you. But I had a commitment. I had some important work. I don't mind. I'll cut off that work, but I will be there for you. You say, what will he feel? As though, you know, I'm trying to impress him. Or he'll feel, no, oh, you've got work, so he will not. No, he won't. Because you're making a categorical statement that I have work, I'm willing to give that up. It could be something as simple as afternoon time you take a nap. Or at night you're an early sleeper. And this person calls you up and says, I want to talk to you, I'm upset, I'm doing this or that. Tell that person. Yeah, normally I take a nap at this time of the day, I get this half an hour off and something. But I don't mind. Since you have a need, it's okay with me. I'm perfectly okay. I'm not doing you a favor. It's for my own self. Because I care for you, I would like to do it. Only then the other person or the other people will realize what you are, you know, doing. And then, if you want something in return, in whatever form, please say so. Like I said, no, with your nearest and dearest also. Say so that this is what I want. Do it with anybody whom you are reaching out unconditionally. It could be a simple thing like telling the person, see, anytime you have an issue, you want to discuss, I'm there for you. You are my good friend, I would like to help you. It's just that, you know, at this time of the day in the evening, the children come back from school and I'm a little tied down and all that. So it's better if we can avoid that. Or, you know, I'm an early sleeper. After 9, 9:30, you know, I get drowsy and I'm not really in a, you know, active mood to be able to carry out a good conversation. So if you want, you know, you call me up earlier or call me in the morning, because if you call me in the night after 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock, I will still talk to you, but I won't be able to do justice to you. So when you start explaining these things, also understand from your own point of view. You good do good to somebody and you don't get any reciprocation. You don't get any returns from that person. There's something very funny about good deeds. You do a good deed to somebody, that person does a good deed to somebody, that person does a good deed to somebody, it takes a whole cycle and comes back to you. And you get good deeds from totally unexpected people whom you have never done anything great in life for. And that person goes out of the way to be nice to you. So there's this thing like a balance of nature, you know. So if you are comfortable with it that, okay, right now I'm doing good to somebody, but I'm not getting it back, it doesn't matter. So when I let go, it comes back to me in some form. You have to believe in that. You have to experience that. And if necessary, even record that. That I remember that X, whom I hardly know, and I've definitely not done any favor to X, but that X came and did a good deed to me. That was part of that cycle. When I was doing good to somebody, I got it back in some other form. And one more very interesting and very important task when you do good to others. Remind yourself that I am fortunate that I am not at the receiving end. You know, this is something we explain to our helping hands volunteers. We have volunteers in 9 different cities of the hospital. And unconditionally they go. They give whatever emotional support and this and that. They help, you know, patients, caregivers and all. Sometimes it can get a little daunting. Sometimes it can get a little depressing. So I tell them, whenever you enter into the hospital, tell yourself, there are patients lying on bed there suffering. Very unhappy. There are queue of patients in the OPD, outpatient, who have come with aches and pains and whatever it is, and they are waiting for the doctor. They are very unhappy people. There are caregivers of the patients who are not sick, who are perfectly healthy, but they know that their loved one is in pain and they have accompanied that person or are sitting next to the bed. They are unhappy. You have hundreds of staff in the hospital. They have hectic duties from doctors down to all the other people, right down to even ward boys, nurses, whoever it is. They are doing night duties, they are doing overtime, they are doing so many things. They are unhappy. You as a volunteer are the only person who can walk in and walk out happily. Knowing that neither are you sick, nor is any loved one sick, nor is somebody questioning you and, you know, asking you for results, or is bossing over you. You come when you want, you go when you want. So in day-to-day life also, I would like you to practice this. Whenever you do good to somebody and you realize that that somebody is going through problems, remind yourself that I am the lucky one who does not have such issues. And that is the reason why I am being able to look up, take care of the other person. The other thing is, don't overdo it. Don't become like, you know, we cannot be a Mother Teresa or a Mahatma Gandhi or whatever. We cannot unconditionally keep giving to people. We cannot keep giving to everybody. So understand your limitations. Don't neglect your own needs. There are times when you feel that I would like to have, you know, just some time to myself. I'd like to do something for myself. I want to pamper myself. I want to go and eat an ice cream all alone. Or I want to go off on a holiday. Or I want to just close the door and sit by myself listening to music and relaxing. Don't neglect yourself while you're doing good to others. That's a very, very, very important thing. And the last thing is, if you are the type of person who has been doing good to others, it comes naturally to you. You don't feel a strain or a burden, and you say, okay, anybody who needs me, anybody who reaches out to me, I will give unconditionally. I won't even have expectations from that somebody. Remember that you are human. You have emotional needs. When you say, I don't care if somebody gives it to me or not, you are only suppressing it. As a human being, you cannot rise to that sublime or that supernatural level where you say, it makes no difference to me. We all have emotions. So the solution to that, the answer to that is, take breaks. Tell yourself, next few days, I'm not going to be available to somebody. Switch off your social media, this, that, whatever it is. And if you can do that, you will realize that you are getting what we call as recharging of your batteries. And you come back with more enthusiasm, more physical and mental energy, and you can continue with your life. Otherwise, you can have a burnout. Okay, Dr. Nikhat is here with me. She has done a very nice, lovely thing very quietly. As I was reading out to you the points of how to deal with the people, she has put it on the chat box. So now that is available to you. So she has filled in that gap of not me not being able to give it to you in written form. So it's there with you. You can at any time access it, and you can get those points which I have just now dealt with. So I've taken a little more time than usual because, as I said, that today I don't have the other facilities, and I'm not on my laptop where, you know, you have that nice chat box coming on the side, so I can read and I can keep answering those things. And also the fact that today is the first Saturday that we are, you know, having at 2 p.m. instead of 11 a.m. So not all our people who are part of our community of understanding human beings and who have been following the FB Live pages, not all of them may be aware. So today, you know, I'm not expecting too much attendance, but it will sink in from now on. As we have already announced to you, we will be having this FB Live program on Saturdays, but at 2 o'clock instead of at 11 o'clock. So now Nikhat is going to tell me the questions that are there already in the chat box. The first one is here, which says, in our culture, we are largely conditioned to put away our needs and the one who is self-sacrificial considered great. To change becomes very difficult because we've even forgotten our needs. Very true. It's our culture, and I'm proud of it. The way we have been imbibed, unlike certain other cultures, is that you should not be selfish. You should not see always to your own needs. You must take care of others. And more so, since a majority of the people who join us on this program are ladies, let me tell you, girls are, you know, taught this much more than boys. A girl right from childhood is told that you have to be that sacrificial lamb. You have to obey your father, then you have to obey your husband, then you have to obey your son, whatever it may be. It's done with very good intentions, and I said I'm proud of that culture. But that does not mean that you should neglect yourself. You should also balance it out. Just add you to that list of other people to whom you have to be good to. That is the subtle dividing line. People who decide to help others all the time will be the people who will have a burnout, as I said. Oh, we have Haider Naseem all the way from Maldives. Welcome, Haider. He says, I am watching this from Maldives. Really miss my Banjara friends. Yes, thank you for being with us, Haider. Today, thanks to technology, distance is no issue. And whenever you do come down to India or to Bangalore, please come and drop in. It's going to be a pleasure to interact with you once again. And I get these responses sometimes from people from all over the world. You know, people who call up or you know, communicate or send an email saying that right now I'm in USA. The timing is inconvenient because you know how the global timing is. But I do like to join up because it gives me that nostalgia, it gives me that sense of belonging or whatever it is. Similarly, Madhu, our old student Madhu Srivastav says, I am watching this from Ajmer. So much going on in the house, but can't miss it. See, this is that little thing, you know. We all do it for somebody or the other. We have this thing of connectedness. And that's where I'm really happy and really proud of our Banjara community. You may be in any part of the country, any part of the world in fact. But somewhere there is this feeling of connect because we have been together, we have spent some time, we have learned something, we have evolved, we have grown. And that includes me also, remember that. Okay, Vinita, who's very much in Bangalore right now, says, yes, Ali, I feel that it's how we have been brought up by our parents, so ingrained into us that we do or give unconditionally. I agree, Vinita, but like I said, you don't have to be all the time giving unconditionally. Give unconditionally, but be selective. Go back to that list which Nikhat has put up for you in the chat box. You will get the tips and pointers that I've given you. And remember, one is to be selective about whom you give, how much you can give, and to take breaks whenever you feel that it's becoming even a slight problem. I have another wonderful student of mine whom I am very, very proud of and I admire very much. It is Dr. Dharanish Prasad, who was earlier a professor of community medicine and is now running what we call as a primary health center. It is amazing work that happens in primary health centers for the poorest of poor who cannot afford any other doctors and hospitals and all that. They get free treatment in these primary health centers, and Dr. Dharanish has chosen to work and head that primary health center. What Dharanish says is, hi Ali and team Banjara, I'm watching the meeting. In between the meeting, yes, he has so many meetings, he has so many patients, but somehow that connect is there, and I always feel nice whenever I find this. Vinita says, yes, totally agree. Sonia says, I love the idea of letting partner and even kids to know what I like. That's very funny, Sonia, that what we tell to others, sometimes we don't tell to the people who are closest to us. That's what TA language, transactional analysis talks about, games people play. With our nearest and dearest, instead of telling them on their face, this is what I want, we play games. We play that hide and seek, cat and mouse type of thing. As if you don't know what I want. As if you don't know what is happening to me. Why don't you tell me what is happening to you? I think that's one thing which we have to keep in mind. Madhu also says, very important this topic. In my life I keep giving, but when I wanted help from others, my own people refused to help me. Now onwards I will be selective. Yes, that is what I'm saying. It is inevitable. It happens to most of us. That somehow we become complacent and we say, since I'm giving to all my near and dear and everybody unconditionally, when I need, I'm sure they'll give it to me. They will not. Let's accept it. Sheila says, people at home don't even realize things that we do for them day in and day out. Acknowledgement or appreciation is never there over the years. Although I have dropped expectation largely, but sometimes
it gets overwhelmed.
Okay. So there's a limitation to what you can put in, I think, on the chat box, so it stops there. Anyway, The point has been raised very vividly by Sheila that yes, you keep giving all these things, but you don't actually get that acknowledgement. There are mothers I know who say that my child treats me as though I am a domestic help or a maid servant in the house. He just doesn't value me and he thinks daddy is everything. Why? Because what daddy does is visible. What mummy does is also visible, but they tend to turn a blind eye to it. Now it is up to mummy to say that this is what I do. Sit down when you have just relaxed in a happy mood and say, you know how my day goes? You know, I get up at this time and this is what I do. I'm not saying it as if that I'm doing a favor to you, or I'm not saying it to have anything in return or expectation from you. I just want you to know. You know, you get up at 8 o'clock, you don't know that by 8 o'clock half my day is over. I just want you to know. I'm not asking you to get up early. I'm not saying that I want anything back from you, but you should know. Communication, I think, is an absolute essential aspect of all close relationships. Unless and until we learn how to communicate openly and not by playing games, as they say in the TA language. With an outsider, we give clear instructions. With our nearest and dearest, we start taunting. We start saying things round and about. And that in fact leads to more and more of conflict, more and more of misunderstanding. And relationship actually gets worse. So once that happens, and it may have happened to you in smaller or greater ways earlier, please do understand the value of being open in your communication. And that should be both verbally and non-verbally. Sometimes you can even show it to them. If you are taking care of a house completely 24/7 and this and that, take 3 days off minus your family and run off to Shakleshpur. Have a nice relaxed time, go back. Don't say anything. But they will know those 3 days what they missed out. What is it that you were doing? Smita says, hi Dr. Ali, such a relevant topic. Good to have you on our thing, Smita. Socialization makes us, especially women, such people pleasers that we sometimes even fail to recognize that we are ignoring and hurting ourselves. You brought out the right points, Smita. Ignoring and hurting others. This is something which, you know, you must understand. You cannot be a sacrificial lamb all the time. There are times when you are actually ignoring and when you're hurting, and being human, you have a limitation to how much you can take ignoring and how much hurt you can take. In fact, physical health or physical pain, comparatively, most of us have a very high threshold. We can bear it. And more so if it's in the interest of somebody else, our family members, whatever it is. But emotional pain is not that easy. Madhu says, I used to wait for my family to acknowledge my work and communication, but they didn't. By 8 a.m. my work gets over. And whole day I wait for their reply to make a program with me. But they have their own life and happiness. Yes, but that's exactly what I have been saying the last half an hour and more. That unless you do, I told you that proverb which we used to be hearing in childhood, that even a mother does not give milk to the child till the child cries. A mother whose love is supposed to be unconditional, how does she know that the child is hungry unless the child cries? The child is a baby, the child has no form of communication except crying. So when the child cries, the mother knows, he is hungry, I'll give him milk. We carry this through to our adult life, and we should be doing it on a continuous basis. Give it a thought. All these things that I'm talking are not some philosophy or whatever it is. I would even say at times, purposely do gestures and good deeds. You know, some of us are wired that way, as some of you also said it. It's in our culture, it's in our upbringing. That you must always care for others, you must, you know, look after the others. So if that is the case, reach out to people who are, you know, who cannot give you any reciprocation, whom you are not going to meet later. Do a gesture to some passerby or somebody else, like how our helping hand volunteers do in hospitals. That patient is never going to come back and thank you or whatever it is. You know it, but you are doing it for your own satisfaction. Okay. Sheila says, I think we need to value ourselves and our time the most. Be very clear and vocal about it while we care for people and do what we like to do for them. Exactly. Sheila, you have condensed back whatever I am telling in a very nice compact form. That we have to, the onus is on us. I can keep complaining the rest of my life that my loved ones don't reciprocate, people don't care, people are insensitive, even when we do good, they don't care for me. I can spend my whole life complaining. What am I going to get? Finally, what is, you know, the, what is my objective? What do I want out of life? I want some good to happen to me. No, we are all social animals, particularly our nearest and dearest, people whom we care for. We want their love and affection. We not only need it, we also want it. So when we want something, like how the baby cries when the baby feels hungry, we have to cry out in different ways. Use your own means, find out whatever is the best way that you can. But be assured that it can be done. You don't have to be that, you know, always that person at the receiving end, the victim or whatever it is. It's not a good quality of life to lead, to be a victim. You should understand that there are ways and means, practical ways and means, without hurting the other person, without creating any problems for the other person. We can, you know, do it. So go ahead, do it, start practicing it. Be in touch if there's any way I or anyone in Team Banjara can be of help. You have our email ID, you have our phone numbers, whenever you feel like, or drop in whenever you want to. The new batch of DCS has started. If you want to come and just say hi to the new babies, you're most welcome to come and spend some time. And as Nikhat has rightly said, without feeling guilty too. That's a very, very important point. Glad you brought that up, Nikhat, that whenever you're doing anything like this, remove guilt from your dictionary. Do not say that, oh, I am doing this, I am neglecting my child and I am going and doing this and that. Let me end up with giving you a very interesting real life example. There's this student of mine who stays not very far from our office, and after passing out, she has been busy with all her life and all that. She's got a teenager daughter, one child only, and she feels very guilty whenever she leaves the child alone at home, even if she's going out for work. One day it so happened, she had to do some shopping for the house, she had to get some grocery, whatever. She finished all that. And she was returning, she dropped in at Banjara. And I said, glad you've come, because 5 minutes later I would have been in the class, I'm going for the class. She said, what's the topic? I mentioned whatever was the topic of that day. She said, that's a very fascinating topic. You know, can I come and listen for some time? I said, sure, you're welcome, come. Then she said, no, actually, you know, I've been out since a long time. My daughter is alone at home. I have to go back. I said, sure, if your daughter needs you, go back. No, but I want to listen to this also. I said, then listen. No, but what about my daughter? I said, simple, call up your daughter. Ask her if she has any need. If she needs you for something specific, otherwise tell her that I'll come after an hour or whatever it is. She called up her daughter. And she gave a long explanation. You know, you wanted this stuff. I have bought that. I've got this thing ready. I'm carrying that for you. I went and finished off with this work. I did all those things. She gave a long explanation. You know, I was returning. I just dropped by in Banjara. And I came to know that Ali is giving a talk on such topic. So I was wondering, you know, that if I stay here and watch, then I will be able to come back only after 1 hour. Is it okay? You know what the kid said? Thank you, mummy. Imagine a teenager wants the house all to herself. She wants the privacy. She'll put on music at loud volume. She'll eat junk food. She'll chat with her friends. She'll do something. She doesn't want mummy all the time with her, right? So that is how we sometimes, you know, tend to take ourselves too seriously and only keep giving. And that is what I always say, that please do not neglect yourself. Please be selective in good that you do. Please have limitations on it. Balance your life with that of others, and you'll find that life is wonderful. And I also mentioned to you, good deeds have a habit of taking a complete round and coming back from some totally unexpected source. Record that and feel that gratitude, and you'll have a wonderful time. So thanks a lot. From now on, every Saturday, we are going to be meeting at 2 o'clock, which I think suits many, many people. Suits me also, in fact, because sometimes Saturday mornings I have some programs. I can finish that and be back well in time at 2 o'clock. So today, we wind up over here. It was a pleasure interacting and a pleasure to get some very nice inputs from you, which I'm also going to be learning from. And I'll see you next Saturday at 2 p.m. with the same Facebook Live. Bye-bye, and have a lovely weekend.